All right, chapter 1 and chapter 2 are kind of longer chapters. Obviously, we go through these, you know, about 50 verses each. And chapter 2 here, we got a lot of politics going on. Of course, Solomon, we saw last week in chapter 1 how there was a little bit of a conflict where Adonijah was thinking that he was just going to take over the kingdom and become king, but it was rightfully going to be Solomon's. And when Adonijah basically threw a party, kind of setting himself up and essentially claiming to be the king, that was told King David, and David was like, you know, he knew about it, but he didn't say anything about it until people actually confronted him, like, what are you going to do about this? Who do you want to be king? And then he, you know, proclaimed Solomon king, and he sat on the throne and everything else. So that was chapter number 1. I'm not going to re-preach all of that. But now we're going to see here, getting started in chapter number 2. And as I mentioned last week, you know, we may not read every single verse. We already read the whole chapter just a minute ago. I'm going to be trying to get into the main points and the concepts that we're going to learn and things that we could learn, the greater teachings from these chapters, other than just the actual fact of history of this is what happened. So let's dig in here a little bit and look at verse number 1. Now the days of David drew nigh that he should die, and he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth. Be thou strong, therefore, and show thyself a man, and keep the charge of the Lord thy God to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes and his commandments and his judgments and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest, and whithersoever thou turnest thyself, that the Lord may continue his word which he spake concerning me, saying, if thy children take heed to their way, to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, a man on the throne of Israel. So David's charging Solomon. He's, you know, he knows that his days are almost coming to an end. He knows that he's about ready to die. And he's giving Solomon his last bit of wisdom and just kind of being, you know, sending him off and saying, look, Solomon, this is what is really important, and this is what you need to focus on. And I love what he tells him here, because he starts off just saying, you know what? I'm going to be gone. You need to be strong. And you think about it, there's a certain comfort. If David were your father, David was a mighty man of valor. David was someone that all the people loved. He was well respected. Everybody looked to David as being an authority, someone in power. But now David's about to die. As his son, as his child, you could trust in your father. You could rely on your father. I'm sure Solomon had a lot of respect for David and was safe as long as David was around, right? But David's saying, I'm gone. I'm going to be gone. So now it's time for you to step up, Solomon. It's time for you to be strong, therefore, and show thyself a man. You need to man up. And this is how you do it. Like, you start to look at verse number 3. He says, you need to be strong and show yourself a man. Verse 3, and keep the charge of the Lord thy God. You know what a real man does? A real man is a godly man. A real man is someone who has respect for God's word, for God's commandments, who could go to the law of Moses and say, thus saith the Lord, and this is how I'm going to live my life in integrity and in truth. You see, the world, it's funny how they want to mock godly men. They want to make godly men look like sissies. They want to make godly men look like weaklings, right? As these pacifist hippies that just, you know, you're just a big pushover and everything else. When David told Solomon to show yourself a man, the way you show yourself a man is by being a godly man, by doing what's right. And by the way, you know, just because the world twists things around and want to make you think that you have to be a soft sissy to be a Christian, that doesn't make it true. I mean, you look at the men of the Bible, you look at Samuel, for example, you look at David, okay? Look at these men, look at Moses, look at the men that the things that they've done and some of the things that they had to do. I mean, I brought up Samuel. Samuel hewed kings in pieces with a sword. I mean, he cut them up and chopped them up. As a Christian man, you look at Jeremiah, look at Ezekiel, you look at these great men that God has used. You look at John the Baptist out in the wilderness, eating locusts and wild honey, right? Living out in the wilderness, roughing it. These are men of God. There's nothing solved about Jacob. There's nothing solved about him. I mean, when all the people had to come together to feed from the well, they had, you know, it took multiple people to remove the cover off the well. Jacob did it by himself. He wrestled with God all night and prevailed. I mean, wrestling, there's so many examples of men in the Bible that are strong. And we, if you want to be a godly man, ought to be strong. And I'm not just saying just physically. Physically, yeah, sure. Bible says bodily, you know, exercise profiteth little. There's a little profit to that. But we need to, way more important even than just being physically strong. I mean, you ought to be a strong man. But you need to be strong spiritually. You need to be able to keep the charge of the Lord. You need to be able to stand tall. You need to be able to stand in your integrity and in the ways of God when everybody's working against you, when everything is going against you, and when the whole world's going to call you crazy. You need to be able to just stand firm and say, I'm going to be a man. This is what God said, and I'm standing with him.
Amen.
Keep the charge of the Lord, verse 3, to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes, and his commandments, and his judgments, and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses. Why? That thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest, and whithersoever thou turnest thyself. You want to prosper in what you do? You get yourself in line with the Bible, with the Scripture, with God's laws, with what God has for you to do. That's guaranteed to make you prosper. Verse number 4, that the Lord may continue his word which he spake concerning me. Now he's bringing up the promise that was given to King David. That great promise, that great blessing where he was humbled by God, basically saying, well, who am I, Lord? Right? Then God prophesied and he promised unto David that of the seed of his loins, the Savior was going to come. That eventually there was not going to be a king to fail from his loins. And the king, of course, is a Jesus Christ. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But even that promise was still conditional. Just like the promise was, you know, it was, there's a promise made to Abraham that was fulfilled in Christ. There's a promise made to David that's fulfilled in Christ. But there's still these promises that he says here in verse 4. Let's look at it. Verse 4, that the Lord may continue his word which he spake concerning me, saying, if, that word if means there's a condition, right? This condition needs to be met. If thy children take heed to their way, to walk before me in truth, with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, a man on the throne of Israel. He says, if you follow my ways, if your children and their children and their children and just will continue to trust in me and walk before me in truth with all their heart, then you know what? I will make sure their kingdom in Israel. And that's a promise. And David's saying, look, this is what God said, and I believe him. You need to man up. You need to be strong. And you need to show yourself a man and follow, you know, Moses' commandments. And this will be true. Now, after this, of course, David starts instructing Solomon to take care of some old unfinished business. We'll read through that a little bit. Let's look at verse number 5. Moreover, thou knowest also what Joab, the son of Zeruiah, did to me, and what he did to the two captains of the host of Israel, unto Abner, the son of Ner, and unto Amasa, the son of Jether, whom he slew, and shed the blood of war in peace, and put the blood of war upon his girdle that was about his loins, and in his shoes that were on his feet. Do therefore according to thy wisdom, and let not his hoar head go down to the grave in peace, but show kindness unto the sons of Barzillai the Gileadite. And let them be of those that eat at thy table. For so they came to me when I fled because of Absalom thy brother. And behold, thou hast with thee Shimei the son of Gera, a Benjamite of Bahurim, which cursed me with a grievous curse in the day when I went to Mahanaim. But he came down to meet me at Jordan, and I swear to him by the Lord, saying, I will not put thee to death with the sword. Now therefore hold him not guiltless, for thou art a wise man, and knowest what thou oughtest to do unto him. But his hoar head bring thou down to the grave with blood. So David slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David. These are his last bits of instruction. Now David was a wise man and a wise king, and he understood the politics. He understood what was going on. I've actually heard this passage preached against David before, that basically he's not able to forgive properly because he held this like a bitterness until the day that he died, telling Solomon to, you know, kill these people and stuff. But I don't see it that way. I really don't think that was some major problem that David had. I think what he's doing is he's looking out for his son with some of this unfinished business, and he knew that the way the politics played in the land, and there was, I think, a couple of things that he should have done that he never ended up doing. I mean, with Joab is a good example of that. He didn't deal with Joab appropriately when he was king with the murders that he did. But again, I'm sure, you know, we don't know all the details, but we know enough. We know that Joab was David's family. We know that he was like his nephew, because it was, he's the son of Zeruiah. And we also know that Joab was a mighty man of valor. He was a great general. I mean, he was leading the armies and the victories. Obviously, God gets the victories, but he was also, you know, Joab was a good man of war and someone that was instrumental for him to have in a position at that time. So, you know, he had these various things being at play in his own decision-making. But what I see here is that it's just David's opportunity to instruct Solomon on doing what's right. And just saying, you know, this is what's right. This is what ought to be done. And, you know, David obviously made mistakes, but he's given the reins of the kingdom over to his son, and he wants the kingdom to be secure with Solomon. And we're going to look at these people now individually in these various things that David is instructing Solomon to do with each one. And we're going to see how Solomon handles that, because he doesn't just start off right off the bat doing exactly everything that David said to do either. Solomon interprets what he says and says, okay, well, here's what I'm going to do. He makes his own decisions, right? David's telling him what he thinks he ought to do, but Solomon does, in a couple of cases, something a slightly different, but we see how it all ends up. So look at verse number, we'll keep reading here, verse number 11. And the days that David reigned over Israel were 40 years. 7 years reigned he in Hebron, and 33 years reigned he in Jerusalem. Then sat Solomon upon the throne of David his father, and his kingdom was established greatly. And Adonijah the son of Haggith came to Bathsheba, the mother of Solomon, and she said, "Comest thou peaceably?" And he said, "Peaceably." Now we're going to see very quickly that Solomon is tested on what type of king he's going to be, and what people are going to be able to get away with him being in charge. And this happens when new kings take the throne all the time. And it's interesting how Adonijah waits until David's dead, because now it's just, you know, before, when Adonijah wanted to be king, David ultimately said, no, it's going to be Solomon, right? But now David's dead, he's gone. So now it's just left up to Solomon. And we're going to see, and in case, I'm going to explain this real briefly. It's not very difficult, but just in case you don't quite get why David kills Adonijah for what he asks, I'm going to explain that to you. We're going to read this real quickly here. Look at verse number 14. Because Adonijah basically goes to Bathsheba. Bathsheba is Solomon's mother. And instead of even going to Solomon, he wants to go and ask her to go talk to the king for him. And to make this request. So right off the bat, she's like, wait a minute, are you coming here in peace? And he's like, yeah, no problem, right? I'm not coming here starting any problems. Verse 14, and he said, moreover, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And she said, say on. And he said, thou knowest that the kingdom was mine, and that all Israel set their faces on me, that I should reign. Howbeit the kingdom is turned about, and is become my brother's, for it was his from the Lord. And we already see the bitterness of Adonijah here. And what's interesting to see about Adonijah is his wickedness, knowing he knew the throne rightfully belonged to Solomon from the Lord. He even said it from his own lips. He says, you know that this kingdom was mine. Everybody was looking at me to reign over the kingdom. It was, you know, basically saying it was rightfully mine, but Solomon took it from me because it was his from the Lord's. From the Lord. You know, if Adonijah cared at all what God wanted, what the Lord wanted, he never would have tried to take the kingdom in the first place. He would have been like, oh yeah, I know, God wants Solomon to reign, so Solomon's going to reign. He wanted it for himself. He knew the throne rightfully belonged to Solomon, yet he wanted it himself. And it's also interesting, if this statement is correct in what he says, now this is just him making this statement, don't know if it's true or not, but if it's true, when he said, all Israel set their faces on me, that I should reign, if that's true, that everybody was basically just looking at Adonijah as he's going to be the next king, it kind of is interesting, at the very least, to see that what men see as being the right choice in a leader, it's not always the same as the way that God sees things, right? If all the people of the land, they thought, Adonijah, yeah, he should be the king. He's the right king for us. But God's like, no, Solomon's the right king for you. Solomon's the one that I've chosen to be over your land. Very oftentimes, you know, I would say every time, the majority of the people are going to be wrong when it comes to knowing what the right thing is to do. God knows, you know, the majority of people aren't even saved. We already know that. So they're going to have a hard time figuring out what is good and what is right according to God. But anyhow, that's just kind of a side note. But it is interesting to see here that Adonijah already, he himself knew that the kingdom belonged unto Solomon because that's who God had appointed. But let's keep reading here. We'll see what he asks of Bathsheba. Verse 16, and now I ask one petition of thee, deny me not. And she said unto him, say on. And he said, speak, I pray thee, unto Solomon the king, for he will not say thee nay, that he give me Abishag the Shunammite to wife. And Bathsheba said, well, I will speak for thee unto the king. Now, if you remember from chapter 1, Abishag, you're like, why would Solomon care if he marries this woman? Well, it's because of who that is. Abishag the Shunammite was the woman that was found for King David to keep him warm. Remember last week in chapter 1? He was old, he was cold, and they found this virgin, they found this maiden to just, you know, minister unto him and do things for him and to provide body heat for him and to keep him warm. So it's basically like, in a sense, the last wife that David had, although the Bible says that he didn't know her, so he didn't like consummate anything with her, have that physical relationship with her. But Adonijah now is asking for her to be his wife. And the reason why that's so sneaky is because Adonijah is still positioning himself to take power. He still wants to have this right and this claim to the throne. And the closer he gets to that, one more step is by saying, hey, now I'm married to this woman that was essentially David's wife, you know, like as a king. And this puts him in a position now just to kind of gain more sway and more political influence in the family. But see, Solomon is, you know, Bathsheba doesn't get it, but Solomon gets it right away. Verse 19, Bathsheba therefore went unto King Solomon to speak unto him for Adonijah, and the king rose up to meet her and bowed himself unto her and sat down on his throne and caused a seat to be set for the king's mother, and she sat on his right hand. Then she said, I desire one small petition of thee, I pray thee, say me not nay. And the king said unto her, ask on my mother, for I will not say thee nay. And she said, let Abishag the Shunammite be given to Adonijah thy brother to wife. Look at verse 22, And King Solomon answered and said unto his mother, and why dost thou ask Abishag the Shunammite for Adonijah? Ask for him the kingdom also, for he is mine elder brother, even for him and for Abiathar the priest and for Joab the son of Zeruiah. So he's saying, well, why don't you just give him the whole kingdom then? I mean, he's asking for you. He's like, don't you see what he's asking for here? He wants to be married to Abishag. Why don't you just go ahead, give him the whole kingdom and Joab and Abiathar and just let them reign? It really angers Solomon now he's asked this, because you remember from chapter 1, Adonijah was real humble. I mean, he was holding on to the horns of the altar, basically saying, don't kill me, Solomon, because he had already tried to steal the kingdom from him. And now he's pulling this stunt to marry, you know, David's, you know, essentially his last wife, or however you want to call it. But this was his way to get in. And this is why Solomon says in verse 23, then King Solomon swear by the Lord, saying, God do so to me, and more also, if Adonijah have not spoken this word against his own life. Adonijah did not want to let it rest. He wanted that kingdom, and he was going to try to be sneaky and sly and get his way in one way or another. And if it wasn't right then, he was going to work at it. And ultimately, you know, the intent of his heart came out, and Solomon just said, that's it. And I believe he did the wise thing. He did. And, you know, back then, it was not even just back then, but the times of the kings, it's cutthroat. You know, just people trying to take over the power, usurp the authority, and that's just kind of the way it was. So he ends up sending to have him die. Verse 24, now therefore as the Lord liveth, which hath established me and set me on the throne of David my father, and who hath made me an house, as he promised, Adonijah shall be put to death this day. And King Solomon sent by the hand of Benaiah the son of Jehoiada, and he fell upon him that he died. And now we're going to start getting into the rest of the business that David had given to Solomon before he died. And it's interesting too. I think that there's no coincidence in the way that the Bible's written here and the way that the chapter reads, that David had given him this information and saying, okay, this, you need to take care of Joab, you need to take care of, you know, these people. And this business with Adonijah kind of triggers Solomon into saying, I got to take care of this. And now I think is when he really starts to take the information that David was giving him and the charges that David was giving him a little bit more seriously. Because he already sees what's creeping up with Adonijah. His father's gone. He's like, I need to make sure that this kingdom is secure. And these other people that have been, you know, almost traitorous against Solomon need to be dealt with. And Solomon sees that now for reality as Adonijah starts making moves. Verse number, where are we? 26. So we're going to see here, Solomon shows mercy unto Abiathar. Verse 26, and unto Abiathar the priest said the king, get thee to Anathoth, unto thine own fields, for thou art worthy of death. But I will not at this time put thee to death, because thou bearest the ark of the Lord God before David my father. And because thou hast been afflicted in all wherewith my father was afflicted. So Solomon thrust out Abiathar from being priest unto the Lord, that he might fulfill the word of the Lord which he spake concerning the house of Eli in Shiloh. Now we're going to get a little of a backstory on Abiathar and who he was. Keep your finger here in 1 Kings chapter 2. Let's go back to 1 Samuel chapter 22. First Samuel 22, we're going to see the story where David was fleeing from Saul. And he goes into the house of the Lord and he asks for the, you know, for a weapon basically, and he gets the sword of Goliath, right? And Doeg the Edomite's there and he sees him. And then King Saul finds out that David was there and he was sent away and they gave him a sword and everything else. And what we're going to see here, look at verse number 11, 1 Samuel chapter 22. Because this is where Abiathar kind of really comes into the story and you get to meet who he is and how, what role he's played with David and everything else. Verse number 11, then the king sent to call Ahimelech the priest, the son of Ahitub, and all his father's house, the priests that were in Nob. And they came, all of them, to the king. And Saul said, hear now, thou son of Ahitub. And he answered, here I am, my lord. And Saul said unto him, why have ye conspired against me, thou and the son of Jesse, and that thou hast given him bread and a sword, and hast inquired of God for him, that he should rise against me to lie in wait as at this day? Now, just in case you don't know, but this, what Saul's asking him about, the first two things are true. He gave him bread and he gave him a sword. But the rest of that's not true. He didn't inquire of God against King Saul or anything like that. He was just going on his way trying to flee from King Saul because he didn't want to be killed. That's all it was. He was not plotting it. But see, Saul had this in his mind all throughout his books. You read it, how he thought David was out to get him and all this other stuff. So Saul calls him here and he's saying, well, what, you know, why are you conspiring against me? Why are you acting like a traitor? Then Ahimelech answered, verse 14, the king, and said, and who is so faithful among all thy servants as David, which is the king's son-in-law, and goeth at thy bidding, and is an honorable in thine house? He's saying, wait a minute, like, because everyone else is thinking, like, I thought David was a great guy. Like, he's your son-in-law. What do you mean? Like, why is it a big deal that I'm helping him out? Verse 15. Did I then begin to inquire of God for him? Be it far from me. Let not the king impute anything unto his servant, nor to all the house of my father. For thy servant knew nothing of all this, less or more. And the king said, thou shalt surely die, Ahimelech, thou and all thy father's house. So he's basically saying, look, I didn't inquire of God for him. So I don't know where you got that from. And he said, I thought David was your son-in-law and that you loved him, you know, whatever. And the king just says, well, you're going to die, you and your father's house. Verse 17, and the king said unto the footmen that stood about him, turn and slay, look at how wicked this is. Turn and slay the priests of the Lord, because their hand also is with David, and because they knew when he fled and did not show it to me. But the servants of the king would not put forth their hand to fall upon the priests of the Lord. King Saul is saying to, you know, kill the God's priests, just kill them. Wipe them out. Why? Because he was just angry that they didn't come and tattle on David for leaving when they didn't even know they were supposed to say anything to the king. They didn't know there was any problem with David. And he's just saying, kill them all. That's some extreme wickedness. You know? And just as a side note, God's mercy, I mean, we know from Scripture that King Saul was in heaven. When King Saul talked to Samuel, after Samuel passed on, he had the witch. You know, he went and consulted with the witch that had familiar spirits. And Samuel talked to Saul. And he said, this day shalt thou, you know, die and thy son shall be with me. And that's the prophecy of being with Samuel. Of course, we know Samuel went to heaven. And doing such a wicked thing as killing the priests of the Lord and still being able to receive forgiveness for that is amazing. But anyhow, let's continue on in this story because I don't want to get too far away from what we're looking at here for Abiathar. Verse 18, and the king said to Doeg, because the other people wouldn't do it, the footmen wouldn't do it. And the king said to Doeg, who was an Edomite, he wasn't of the children of Israel, right? He was this foreigner, which, by the way, is what the government always is going to try to do when people within its own country aren't going to, you know, go against their own countrymen or do things that are wrong. They'll hire mercenaries. They'll hire these foreign actors to come in because they don't have as much of a problem with it. And when you look at you know, dictators and people have taken over countries even from within, it's a lot harder for countrymen to turn against themselves and to kill other people that are their kin, as opposed to bringing foreigners in to do the dirty work for them. And that's what he did with Doeg the Edomite here. He says, the king said to Doeg, turn thou and fall upon the priests. And Doeg the Edomite turned, and he fell upon the priests, and slew on that day 85 persons that did wear a linen ephod. 85 priests got killed, got murdered that day as a result. And you know, that's how, as a real side note, the UN's going to be, when you have all these other foreign, you know, we have this UN force, whenever that comes to the United States, watch out, because it's going to be a lot easier for the people, you know, the Chinese troops and the German troops and the, you know, what, just Russian troops, whatever, play troops from any other countries to be able to come in and deal with us here than it's going to be for, you know, the U.S. military to turn on its own people. It's a lot harder to do that. But anyways, let's keep going here. Verse number 19. And Nob, the city of the priests, smote he with the edge of the sword, both men and women, children and sucklings, and oxen and asses, and sheep with the edge of the sword. He killed everybody. I mean, he just destroyed the whole town. Verse 20, and one of the sons of Ahimelech, the son of Ahitub, named Abiathar, escaped and fled after David. So one guy escaped, and that's who Abiathar is. And he was of the priests. He was a priest himself, and he served with David. Let's keep reading. Verse 21, and Abiathar showed David that Saul had slain the Lord's priests. And David said unto Abiathar, I knew it that day when Doeg the Edomite was there, that he would surely tell Saul, I have occasioned the death of all the persons of thy father's house. Abide thou with me, fear not, for he that seeketh my life seeketh thy life, but with me thou shalt be in safeguard. So David takes him in, and he's like, look, I'm sorry this happened. You know, it's basically my fault that, you know, that all those people are dead, but stay with me. You're all alone now. Stay with me. I'll keep you safe, because the same people that are going to want you dead are the same people that want me dead. So stick with me. And he keeps Abiathar with him. Verse 11, then the king sent to call him like the priest, the son of Ahitub, and all his father's house. I'm sorry. We already read that. Verse 18, and the king said to... Okay, well, that's all I wanted to read then. This is bizarre.
22 is, I think,
where you were last at. Okay, yeah, 22. And then 23 says, abide thou with me, fear not, for he that seeketh my life, seeketh thy life, but with me thou shalt be in safeguard. I have a repeat of all these verses in my notes. So it's just like, goes back to verse 11 where we started and down to 23 again. So anyways, skip that, but that's fine. So that's who Abiathar is, and that's where he came from. He came out, he was the only one that escaped from Doeg the Edomite, who destroyed everyone else in his family. Now, go back to 1 Kings chapter 2. Verse 27, so Solomon thrust out Abiathar from being high priest unto the Lord. Because Abiathar had then served David for like his whole reign. He was with King David, and he stuck with him, and he was faithful to David. So in chapter 1, though, Abiathar went with Adonijah. He kind of, you know, he made the wrong choice. He should have stuck around and been faithful to Solomon. Because like I said, I mean, it was known that Solomon was going to be the next one on the throne, according to God. And Abiathar was a priest. And when he went and supported Adonijah, that was wicked of him to even do that also. But Solomon says, okay, well, because of your history with David, my father, because of how you served him, because of everything, you know, basically I'm going to show mercy on you, but you're not going to be priest anymore. You're going to have to just go and get out of here and just stay away from me, you know, and do your thing. And verse 27 says, so Solomon thrust out Abiathar from being priest unto the Lord. But what's really interesting about all this is that this all fulfills another prophecy of God. It says that he might fulfill the word of the Lord, which he spake concerning the house of Eli in Shiloh. Eli is another one that I brought up last week. Remember, we're going over the different parenting. Eli was the one who ended up raising Samuel. And Eli's sons were wicked. And I'm going to just read for you real briefly back from 1 Samuel chapter 2. We went over this last week, but I want to read this for you again. How, if you remember, how he honored his sons above the Lord. Because he basically allowed his sons to do the wickedness and to cause people to hate the sacrifices unto the Lord. And they were fornicating with the women and all this other wickedness that they were doing. They were sons of Belial. They were sons of the devil. Okay? And Eli didn't do anything about it. And because he didn't do anything about it, he got a curse from God that basically, we'll read the curse. But Abiathar was the son of Ahimelech, who was the son of Ahitub, who was the son of Phinehas, the son of Eli. So he's basically in that descendancy from Eli. And in 1 Samuel 2, I'll start reading for you from verse 27. And there came a man of God unto Eli. So this is the curse, the man of God that's going to say unto Eli, and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, did I plainly appear unto the house of thy father when they were in Egypt in Pharaoh's house? And did I choose him out of all the tribes of Israel to be my priest, to offer upon mine altar, to burn incense, to wear an ephod before me? And did I give unto the house of thy father all the offerings made by fire of the children of Israel? Wherefore kick ye at my sacrifice and at mine offering, which I have commanded in my habitation, and honorest thy sons above me, to make yourselves fat with the chiefest of all the offerings of Israel, my people? Verse 30, wherefore the Lord God of Israel saith, I said indeed that thy house and the house of thy father should walk before me forever. That's what the promise he did have. He says, but now, the Lord saith, be it far from me, for them that honor me I will honor, and they that despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Behold, the days come that I will cut off thine arm and the arm of thy father's house, that there shall not be an old man in thine house. He's saying the days are going to come when there's going to be no old men in your house. Verse 32, and thou shalt see an enemy in my habitation, in all the wealth which God shall give Israel, and there shall not be an old man in thine house forever. And the man of thine, whom I shall not cut off from mine altar, shall be to consume thine eyes and to grieve thine heart, and all the increase of thine house shall die in the flower of their age, and this shall be a sign unto thee, that shall come upon thy two sons, upon Hophni and Phinehas. In one day they shall die, both of them. And I will raise me up a faithful priest that shall do according to that which is in mine heart and in my mind. And I will build him a sure house, and he shall walk before mine anointed forever. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left in thine house shall come and crouch to him for a piece of silver and a morsel of bread, and shall say, put me, I pray thee, into one of the priest's offices, that I may eat a piece of bread. This was the curse that came upon Eli because he honored his sons above God in doing what was right. And we see all of that got fulfilled. When Doeg the Edomite slew 85 men, basically all of Eli's house, when he says there's going to come a day when there's not going to be an old man in your house, that's when they all got wiped out. Now, he didn't say that his entire household was going to be destroyed from off the face of the earth, because that didn't happen. But he did say then those who are left, they're just going to be begging for a job. They're going to be begging to be put into any type of priest office at all. And that was Abiathar then, basically the last guy that escaped from there, being cast out from the priesthood, from having any of those jobs. So now, obviously, Abiathar could have children and whatever, and that line didn't have to be destroyed, but they're not anymore going to be serving God. And this was all that fulfillment of the prophecy from that man of God that spake unto Eli. God's word never fails. And this is just one more point. Just this is what's going to happen. Now, didn't take that long to fulfill, but this was when Samuel wasn't even the judge yet, right? You still have all the time of Samuel being a judge, and then the people finally wanting to have a king, and then King Saul being anointed, and then this comes down from King Saul, and this disaster happens. So, you know, we're talking some decades here went by to the fulfillment of this prophecy. And then ultimately the fulfillment, because it didn't even happen until Solomon's day, which obviously King David came after Saul, and then Solomon came after David died. So the kind of the final piece of this, when Abiathar is just ultimately cast out of being a priest, is the fulfillment that we saw here in 1 Kings chapter 2. So all of that to say this, look at the repercussion of putting your children before God. Let that sink in. I mean, any father here should know. I mean, I love my children today. Like my wife and my children, I love more than any other person in this world, right? But you know who comes first? God does. And when you have wicked children and you're going to put your child above God, not a wise thing to do. Not a wise thing to do at all. We need to make sure that we are always keeping God at our forefront and not letting any other relationship come in the way between us and our God. Let's go back to 1 Kings chapter 2. Now we're going to look at Joab. We're going to look at Solomon's dealings with Joab. Verse number 28. Then tidings came to Joab, for Joab had turned after Adonijah, though he turned not after Absalom. And Joab fled unto the tabernacle of the Lord and caught hold on the horns of the altar. So he did the same thing that Adonijah did. And what's interesting here, though, it says that, you know, Joab at first, when Absalom was betraying David and was trying to take over the kingdom, Joab didn't fall for that. He didn't go after Absalom. He stuck with David. But right here near the end, when Adonijah was basically trying to do the same thing and Solomon, the rightful king, he ended up making the wrong choice and going after Adonijah. So now he knows it's his time. Joab hears about what happened to Adonijah and he's like, uh-oh, like this is coming on me now. So he goes and he runs to the altar. And basically, they tell King Solomon that, hey, you know, Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, is sent to go kill him. He said, okay, well, now go take Joab's life. And he goes and he's at the altar and he's like, he doesn't know what to do because he doesn't really want to kill him there, like at the altar, right? Like in the place where they worship God and stuff. It would be kind of like coming to church, like killing somebody in church, you know, like go kill this guy. And he's just like hiding out in church. Like, well, I don't really want to do it here. You know, it's like a holy place, right? I want to do that. And what Joab said. Look at verse 30. It says, Benaiah came to the tabernacle of the Lord and said unto him, thus saith the king, come forth. And he said, nay, but I will die here. So Joab said, no, I'm going to die right here, you know. So Benaiah goes back and he tells Solomon, he's like, well, this is what Joab said to me. And verse 31, and the king said unto him, do as he hath said and fall upon him. He's like, well, then do it. Right? He's saying, I'm going to die here, then just kill him there. And that's what he does. And it says, and the king reinforces the why he's doing it. Verse 31, and the king said unto him, do as he hath said and fall upon him and bury him, that thou mayest take away the innocent blood which Joab shed from me and from the house of my father. Because Joab did, he commit cold-blooded murder. When he killed Abner, the son of Ner, he did it secretly, you know. And what a shameful way for him to kill another captain of the host. Because Abner was the captain of the host for King Saul. He was the mighty man. He was a general, you know, in that army. And he just kind of sneakily, you know, got him and killed him. Didn't even see it coming. And, you know, he did that to him, and then he also did that to Amasa when David made Amasa the captain of the host instead of Joab. And anyhow, you could read those stories and see that. And that was extremely wicked for Joab to do those things. So now he's basically, you know, Solomon doesn't want that innocent blood that he shed being a curse for his household. So he's like, your blood needs to be shed to atone for that innocent blood that was shed. Way too late in the coming, but at least Solomon set it straight. And then let's keep reading here, verse 32. And the Lord shall return his blood upon his own head, who fell upon two men more righteous and better than he, and slew them with the sword, my father David not knowing thereof, to wit, Abner the son of Ner, captain of the host of Israel, and Amasa the son of Jether, captain of the host of Judah. And that's another important point. David didn't send him to do these things. David didn't even know until after the fact. Now, he did end up knowing, but he still didn't do anything about it. But he found out way later, and it was not of King David that those things were supposed to happen. Verse 33, their blood shall therefore return upon the head of Joab and upon the head of his seed forever. But upon David and upon his seed and upon his house and upon his throne, there shall be peace forever from the Lord. So that was King, that was not King, that was Joab. And of course, David had told Solomon that he needs to bring his whore head. Whore just means white. You know, he's an old man by then, that not to hold Joab guiltless. He needs to be taken care of. Now we come to Shimei. Now Shimei behaved himself poorly against the house of David. He was basically already suspected to be against the king all the way back from when he cursed King David as he left Jerusalem. When Absalom took over and David fled, Shimei was cursing him on the way and throwing rocks at him as he was leaving the Jerusalem, kind of in shame as Absalom was taking over. And then, of course, Absalom dies and David returns back to Jerusalem. Then Shimei meets him and he's basically just saying like, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean it, you know, have mercy on me. And David swears with an oath and he says, all right, I'm not going to kill you. Now, David stayed true to his word. Even though, you know, with everything he was doing, he was worthy of death, you know, I'm sure back then, according to being a traitor and treasonous and everything else by cursing out David, who was the rightful king back then. But he shows mercy to him. And what we see here, also Solomon shows mercy here. David said that basically you need to take care of him, Shimei, that you know what's right with him. But Solomon shows him a little bit of mercy. And what we see here, though, is, of course, Shimei doesn't take the king seriously and ends up disobeying his command. Because what Solomon's command was, you need to go to your house and you need to stay there. You can't be leaving and going abroad and going anywhere else for any other reason. You just stay, you know, you're kind of exiled to your place. And I don't want you going into these other countries. And it says in verse 39 here, 1 Kings chapter 2, and it came to pass at the end of 3 years that two of the servants of Shimei ran away unto Achish, son of Maacah, king of Gath, and they told Shimei, saying, behold, thy servants be in Gath. So his servants run away unto another country, unto Gath. Gath belonged unto the Philistines. And they go there, so Shimei gathers his stuff and goes after him and brings him back. Now, not only had Solomon told him not to leave, but he went abroad to that foreign country. He went to the Philistines, and it's like he's already suspected as being like a traitor, right? For saying all the things he said against David. Now Solomon needs to make sure that his kingdom's established. What's Shimei going to do, right? And regardless of the reasons, like, you're going to a foreign country. You're going to the Philistines, who are our enemies. And you say it's because of your servants, you know? But this is why I told you, you can't leave. You can't go anywhere else. So, of course, look at verse 44. The king said moreover to Shimei, thou knowest all the wickedness which thine heart is privy to, that thou didst to my father, to David my father. Therefore the Lord shall return thy wickedness upon thine own head, and King Solomon shall be blessed, and the throne of David shall be established before the Lord forever. So the king commanded Benaiah the son of Jehoiada, which went out and fell upon him that he died, and the kingdom was established in the hand of Solomon. So, you know, Solomon approached Shimei and he's like, look, this is what I told you to do. You agreed with it. You said that that word's good. And now you just left. How quickly these words just fade away, right? 3 years. And it cost him his life. And Solomon stuck true. And basically it says here, you know, in the last verse, and the kingdom was established in the hand of Solomon. Solomon had to make some tough decisions and he had to be strong. You know, when he said something, he can't go back on that. He can't be that kind of king. That's the only way the kingdom could be established. So the promise that he made when he showed mercy to Shimei, he said, okay, well, this is what you need to do. When he breaks that, he had to follow through justly on what he had said that he would do. And not be someone who says one thing but doesn't actually follow through with it, because then everyone's going to run all over you. With Adonijah, the same thing. He says, okay, you got to show yourself to be an upright guy. You know, no wickedness should be found in you in chapter 1. And then in chapter 2, what does he do? He's already trying to move in. He's already trying to make some moves against the king. Boom. He had to deal with them appropriately. And as a result of him making these, I believe, are wise decisions, tough decisions. He needed to be strong to make those decisions. But that is what helped him to secure and to establish himself as the king. And then everyone else is going to realize, don't mess with King Solomon. When he says something, you know, you better believe he's going to follow through in it. And that's something, on a side note, as parents, you ought to be able to do with your children. You know, when you say something to your children, you have to follow through on that. I mean, he would have no respect if Shimei just got away with this. Oh, well, you just went to go get your servant, so okay, I'm not going to do it. Even though I said if you leave, you're going to be put to death. You know, I guess I'm not going to do that this time because whatever. No one's going to have any respect for anything you say then. And when you have kids, I mean, you're not going to kill your kids, right? So don't be telling your kids, look, if you do that again, I'm going to kill you. And I know people say that, they're kind of joking around. But you ought to be able to tell them things. If you tell them not to do something, and if you do, this is going to be the result, you need to follow through with that, because they need to understand that when you say something, you mean it, and they'll have respect for you. And that goes in all areas of life, not just your children. If you're a boss, you got people working for you, you know, whatever it is that you do, your word should be important to you. And if you want to establish yourself, maybe you're not the king, right? We don't have a king. You're not establishing yourself as the ruler in the kingdom. But if you just want to establish yourself in any capacity, be true to your word. Be faithful to your word. And the things that you say, you should let them come to pass. All the loose ends were tied up, and there's no more threats to Solomon's household. And then he begins his reign. And we're going to get into further into Solomon's reign in many chapters to come here in 1 Kings. Let's bow right to that word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this great book of the Bible. Lord, I pray that you would please help us all to be strong. Lord, help us to be able to stand strong when there's tough decisions to be made. Help us to stand strong and walk in the integrity of our heart, and that we would do right according to your word, dear Lord. Help us to never stray from what you have written for us in your word, dear Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.